Hello, my friends. Welcome back to another video. I'm doing a second movie review this week. In the last couple days, I was thinking that I was going to review the movie The Platform, but maybe that'll come in a couple days. What I want to do this time is again report on a movie I just rewatched. Now, the movie is It Follows. It's in the horror genre as well, and I suppose, like in a way, I suppose Donnie Darko was in the horror genre. These movies have a lot in common in the sense that the suspense, the pacing, the suspense, and the depth, and the possibility of interpretation, the different interpretations. So I'm going to offer you my interpretation. Now, it's funny how with the second watch, so I watched it first probably, I don't know, 4 or 5 years ago, and really enjoyed it. But the second watch, I noticed things I hadn't seen before or didn't remember. But the general gist of what the movie was about was the same for me. But I was able, able to piece things together, if there is such a thing as in this postmodernist age of a single interpretation. And what do you mean when you say the movie is about this? So it had a common writer-director, David Robert Mitchell. And so, with anything, if you wanted to say, well, what's this movie about? You'd have to ask him, and he'd have to say yes or no, right? Or that's consistent, or that falls within the range of ideas I was working with, or not, okay? So just to the raw stats here, It Follows was released in 2014. It starred Micah Monroe, who's extremely extremely beautiful in classic blonde brown eyes in this case, young woman. She's a university student in the movie, so you're looking at about roughly a 20-year-old. The budget for the movie was $1.3 million. And it made $23.3 million, so it was much more successful in its initial release than say was even Donnie Darko, right? With its budget to box office comparison. So this movie, like Donnie Darko, is a masterpiece, but of a different sort. Now, the greatness of this movie lies mostly in the suspense. Okay, so the philosophy that I'm going to be discussing is secondary, whereas in Donnie Darko, the philosophy is primary. Okay, so the experience of the movie, you can experience this movie as a horror movie or as a suspense movie, and doctrine aside, ideas aside, they add as much as you want them to add, but the movie can exist and be enjoyed on its own, right, without reference to those things. Now, you know me in this channel, I like to look a little more deeply and look at ideas, and I find, you know, my discussion here is about those ideas. So the general plot of the movie is that there's this malevolent creature that takes the form of human beings, and these human beings basically are walking towards their victim. They walk at a regular pace, so you know, picture that horrible inevitability of being pursued by Jason Voorhees. Jason Voorhees never runs; he walks, and he's unrelenting, and he's unstoppable. So that's kind of the feeling here. So initially, and of course, importantly, the specter, or whatever you want to call it, is interested in the person who is passing on this curse through sex. Okay, so initially we discover that it's a young man, and he has sex with the main girl. Okay, this Annie girl, played by Micah Monroe, and Anna becomes the prey of this specter for the rest of the film. Obviously, it's a movie about sex. It's a movie about victimization. It's a movie about how our bad actions affect others. Okay, that's all pretty easy surface level experience of this movie. And as I said, the movie is terrifying enough and enjoyable enough in the ominous pace and in the novel use of an everyday character being the vehicle of the specter. Okay, so it can be it take again it takes the form of just about anything. The first specter that Annie sees is a naked woman who's walking towards her, and that in it of itself is bizarre enough. And the second form the specter takes is of an old lady dressed in like a nightgown, who's very much out of place because she's on at her university campus in class as she sees this figure walking towards her in the quad, right? And then she leaves the class, and suddenly the specter is walking down the hall, and it's clear immediately that she's the only one who can see this thing, this being that's pursuing her. Never runs, it never hurries, it walks. Okay, so the pacing is really, really, really works. And one thing I said about the characters in Donnie Darko a few days ago was that there's no overacting, there's no overemphasis. I had an awesome quote from Camus' Myth of Sisyphus that I wanted to use in this context to illustrate my point, but I can't find the quote right now. I looked and I looked. But basically, it's the old theory of more is less, or sorry, less is more, and more is less. That there's nothing remarkable, there's nothing Hollywoody about the actors, about the pacing, the threats, and so on. It works in the sense that all the greatest, in my opinion, all the greatest horror movies work is when they take an everyday thing and just twist it a bit, twist it towards evil, make something very familiar evil suddenly. Okay, so the hockey mask in Jason, the William Shatner mask in Halloween. And in other cases, one of the most I thought most powerful scenes in a zombie movie is the quiet suburban scene at the start of the remake, the 2004 remake of Dawn of the Dead. It doesn't take place in an underground cavern, not even a mall, not in something that's so obviously a soundstage or whatever. It takes place in harmless white suburbia. Okay, and that contrast between this safe environment, this is not downtown Detroit or anything, this is a safe environment, and this horrible new reality of these zombies is what does it, because most moviegoers would associate suburbia with safe and comfort and lack of violence and all these things. So in terms of this movie, it follows most of the times the specter takes the form of a something familiar or harmless, and they say that is because that's the way that this creature can get closer, right? A few times it adopts an appearance of the horrible, and there's something to be said about that. There's a meaning behind that, I believe, and I'll comment on that in a moment. So the main character, Annie, is in a way, she's super beautiful, and that serves a point. Now, it's interesting how they display her beauty. She's in a bathing suit a few times, and she doesn't have big breasts or protruding buttocks or whatever. She has a very normal sort of body of a young woman, and she's always in a full piece bathing suit. It's not overtly sexual, but it is understated sexuality that is itself alluring, right? So that's one of the themes throughout the movie is the ineradicability or the omnipresence of sexuality. Okay, so even the characters who are helping Annie are also sexual, and this reinforces the fact that the damage and the stakes are there's something about them that this is not an extraordinary situation, but this is the normal situation. So why wouldn't they have like an overtly sexual woman with abnormally large breasts and so on as the character? Because that would be hitting it on the nose too hard. So there's a scene, for instance, where the main character, who I said is extremely beautiful, but it's a remarkable beauty of the face, right? Where she is in the bathroom, standing in her underwear, and her body is that of a normal young woman. Okay, so breasts normal, a bit of, I would say, a bit of fat around the stomach. This is not a washboard stomach. There's no huge difference between waistline and hips, right? So, and there's a feeling that of fragility in this, of Annie being uncertain of her sexual power, okay? And that's real, and that's an authentic experience of being young. That's the main theme of the movie, is not the loss of sexual purity, okay, as a religious notion, but it's the loss of innocence. So there's a very important scene towards the start of the movie where the first guy to pass on the sexual curse is asked, who would you like to change places with in this movie theater? And he points out a little boy. He says that I would like to go back and be a child again. And that's key to interpreting the movie here. And I found this something interesting. When I was studying St. Augustine's theology, one of Augustine's main ideas is the doctrine of original sin. He really worked out the nuts and bolts of it. And he realized, in looking at the Garden of Eden scene of original sin, he realized that sexuality was at the heart of what was going on here. And you know, he wrote hundreds of pages on this in several different works. And one of the things that he's been blamed for is saying that sex is itself a sin. Now, he doesn't say that, and nor does he say that original sin is sex. He puts the two close enough together so that you can conclude that sex is a medium of sin, okay? And I think that is the exact idea that runs through this movie. Sex is the medium by which innocence is lost. And the loss of innocence is not just the loss of the pleasures of childhood, but it is coming to grips with the fundamental, I would say, two fundamental ideas. The first is more obvious than the second. So the first fundamental idea is that you are mortal and you will die someday. And this is made explicit at the end of the movie, where one of the characters quotes from Dostoevsky's The Idiot. There's two quotes from The Idiot in this movie, and the second one, I'll read it. I won't read it for you. I'll put it up on the screen here, okay? So you can read it for yourself. So the first way we lose innocence is realizing that we're not going to live forever, that we're going to grow old, suffer, and die. That's the first loss of innocence. Now, how is that connected to sexuality? It's very interesting that I don't know who said this, but again, I associate with Augustine and something in the ancient church. It could have been the ancient Greek or Roman medical writers. I can't remember where this came from, but they looked at, they considered an orgasm as a death, right? So it's a momentary loss of consciousness, and so you can see a parallel there. And if you look at the physiology and the psychology of sex, is very interesting how something changes in the before and the after. And towards the start of the movie, where Annie has her sexual experience with that first guy, she starts talking about how she thought love would be, her first love would be. She talked about holding hands and all that stuff. And you get a real sense that that's not what it was, and that something has changed by this sexual experience. There's been an awakening, and what she sees is not positive. Okay? So that's the first way that sex leads to a loss of innocence. The second way is that you begin to see people as they are, in that they've taken something from you. So, and they've committed an act of violence against you because they're selfish. This comes across several times, where even the boy, one of the main characters, who loves Annie questions him at one point and says, Do you want what's best for me? Right? And that's a legitimate question, because the boy craves Annie, right? And in love, there is a craving, a selfish craving. Annie's able to point that out with this man. There's mixed motives here, right? There's jealousy, there's selfishness, there's self-gratification, there's always a taking aspect. And knowing full well this curse, right, this sexual curse, knowing full well that you're going to pass it on to somebody else when you have sex with them, has to be a negative act, has to be a taking. Now, this only accentuate the theme of everyday life, that there is something corrupting about sex. There's something corrupting because, I don't know, because it's never truly selfless. And one of the things that reinforces this is that almost all, but not all, almost all of the shapes that this specter takes on in some way embody sexual violence. So sometimes it's very plain. Like one time, it looks like it's a girl who's been obviously raped and traumatized. It looks almost like a prostitute who was raped. And the nakedness of this that the t specter takes a few times, both once as a man and a few times as women, is very jarring and exploitative. It seems very exploitative. One time, at least one time, the specter takes the shape of a boy. And you say, well, how, like a young boy, so say an 8 or 10 year old, and you say, well, how does that relate to sexuality? Well, it very much relates to sexuality in terms of perhaps the boy was abused. Okay? Now, I'm pretty sure that the last manifestation of the specter is Annie's father. Annie's father only appears once in a photograph. He's never referred to in the movie, but he appears once in a photograph in their house. And I'm pretty sure that is the same guy who's the last takes is the last form of the specter. Now, there's something wrong with Annie's mother. She's only shown a few times in the movie, and her absence is means basically that there's something wrong with her, that she's either she's neglectful, or she's got her own problems. And the absence of the father is never explained, but it's suggested that there's something bad must have happened in the family. Okay, so one of the things here is the subtlety of inference. Okay, as I said, this makes for a great movie. The subtlety of inference. Annie has a younger sister, a couple years younger, who's very striking herself, very beautiful. And the only time you see a girl in a bikini top is her, and it's very quickly, and she's bustier than her sister Annie. And you're made to be aware that one of the older boys notices her, right? And she sort of smiles or whatever, so that the sexual dynamism is constantly working, and it becomes absurd in a sense, because how can you feel sexual desire at a time like this, when you're being your best friend, or your friend is your loved one is being chased and hunted down by a ghost who's going to kill her? But sexuality remains. It's just powerful, and the selfishness of sexuality is constant, right? And in this movie, it's not made blatant, you're not hit over the head with it, but it is continual and constant, that despite the dire circumstances, that it still is doing its thing, it's still lusting, right? A few other things. The setting of the movie is Detroit. You're not really told that at first. You have to kind of infer that, because 8 Mile Road is referenced. And now, people who know about 8 Mile have either lived in Detroit or know the movie with Eminem, the rapper Eminem. 8 Mile is, and they tell you this in the movie, 8 Mile is the road that basically is the boundary between the good part of Detroit and the bad part of Detroit. And they're told that when they're kids, their mothers wouldn't let them go past 8 Mile. Now, the climax of the movie takes place in 8 Mile, so you see all the rundown houses and so on. And it's interesting that it also takes place in a public pool, okay? And public pools conjure up ideas of pedophilia and rape and exploitation and voyeurism and kidnapping and all this stuff. And all the nasty swimming coaches and all that stuff. So, and I think that's on purpose. So the climax of the movie takes place in that part of the city where these young people, where as kids they weren't allowed to go. Okay? So it's a passing over out of childhood in a rather blatant manner. And the fact that her last assault comes by the specter that looks like her father is also really quite telling in this case. So, ideologically or philosophically speaking, this movie is very provocative. Now, we don't like to talk about it's not socially sophisticated to talk about the negative side of sexuality. Sexuality since the 60s was supposed to be liberating and positive and beneficial, and that any kind of modesty or shame attached to sexuality is treated as passé, as repressive, as Christian traditionalism, and groundless, that there's no reason for it. But it's almost like this movie is an argument for saying that innocence needs to be protected and sexuality has to be taken into serious consideration in this whole thing. So I think I've hit on all the points that I wanted to talk about with this. And again, this movie can be enjoyed as a horror movie, as a scare fest, or you can really think about it. And I really think that it works so well because the movie has those two dimensions. And so whether you're aware of the two dimensions or not, it's kind of like salt and pepper or oil and vinegar. They both get together and they make something better, right? Something more enjoyable than, say, a slasher film of itself or a thoughtful, philosophical movie by itself, so that it has both of these dimensions. So for Annie, like she's at one point, Annie's sister and friends say, she's so pretty. Yeah, it's annoying, says the sister. So the sister loves Annie very much or whatever, but there's that constant contest of this selfish side of things. And Annie's sister's two friends are always around. One's sort of a the one's the girl, the kind of nerdy girl who quotes from Dostoevsky, and one's the boy who's better friends with the younger girl, the younger sister, than the older sister, but has always been friends with both of them. But his love for Annie and his jealousy with respect to the boys that sort of that orbit sort of around Annie is palpable and really obvious throughout most of the movie. So, but nobody gets off free. Nobody gets off unscathed in that sense. So even the heroes are flawed, and that there's a few times one time is obvious, and another time is implied, where Annie tries to pass off the curse to other people. Now, that's an intrinsically selfish thing. You can say, well, to save my life means to kill another, right? Basically, it was unfairly done to me, therefore I'm going to unfairly do it to somebody else. Now, in the root, we have to answer the question, well, how does that relate to sexuality? Is sexuality always violence? Is sexuality always a taking from? I think the only conclusion is yes. This movie forces you to say yes. sexuality is always a taking from. And I think when we become, when we come to grips with that, when we face that truth, that only then can we make maturer and more moral decisions with respect to our sexuality. Because there is a worse and a better. There's a worse and a better sexuality in this. You're not quite sure what it consists in, but you know the bad when you see it, right? And so you have to infer, well, what's the good then? Anyway, I highly recommend this movie. Super, super interesting, super enjoyable, super suspenseful. Anyway, have a great day, guys, and we'll probably come back with a Myth of Sisyphus review shortly. Thanks. Take care.